big mabuhay to all of you. And a big mabuhay to all those who are watching on satellite and web stream all over the world. Amen. Let's bow our head for a word of prayer. Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, once again we come before your holy presence in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ this evening. Thank you for gathering all your dear children from far and near for the last 3 days. Your children have come, Lord, from far and from the city of Manila to be gathered in your holy presence to celebrate this wonderful Feast of Tabernacles in your holy presence. Thank you for giving us this opportunity where we can be gathered unto you. Thank you for blessing us with this wonderful opportunity where we can come before your holy presence to minister unto you, to be gathered unto you as one body and one spirit. Unless you invite us, your word tells us no one can come before you. So we thank you for this honor. We thank you for this privilege. We thank you for this favor that you gave us, that we may be gathered unto you. And now I ask you, Father, to stretch out your blessing hands and bless each and every one of your dear sons and daughters who are gathered here before your presence. Lord, whatever blessings they need, whether a healing or a miracle or a blessing, give their needs tonight. Tonight, let them receive their miracles, Lord. Tonight, open their eyes that they may see your glory. Tonight, let them experience a touch from you. Tonight, let them have an encounter with you, Lord. Tonight, let them also hear the roar from the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And we pray now. I ask you, Spirit of the Living God, you will open our hearts, you will open our ears, and give us an understanding heart and a listening ear that we may hear what the Spirit of God will speak to the nation. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. I don't have one for be seated. Please be seated. Once again, I greet all of you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I sincerely like to thank our respected Bishop Dan and the IFP board for inviting us to be with you during this wonderful occasion. It's been a wonderful joy for Dr. Bruce Allen and his dear wife, Reshma Allen, and for Pastor Joe Sweet and I to be in your midst during these days. Thank you for showing us your great... Oops. Sorry. Thank you for showing us your great Filipino love. Salamat po. And I am sure it will not end today. Right? Will you continue to love us? How much? This much? This much? This much? This much? Is that all? Only this much? For how many days? 1 day? 2 days? Every day? Yes or no? Every day till the coming of the Lord? Oh, you all are wonderful saints. I wish I can take all of you back to Chennai. Will you come? Yes, but my suitcase is not big enough to put all of you there. It's all right. After you all get trained, then you all come as missionaries to India. Amen. And then you must turn India upside down. Amen. Do you believe that God can use you to do that? Not only India, but you must go all over the world. That is the will of the Lord. Amen. Because God is going to raise up the Filipino church to be apostolic and prophetic. Amen. The whole nation will become apostolic and prophetic. Then you will go forth to pioneer, and you will go forth to prophesy unto the nations of the world, to different people group, to kings, to princes, to everybody. Amen. Now, this is a wonderful days of festive joy, and during this period, I've been sharing with you about the encounters I had with the chief prince angel of the Philippines on the 17th of October while I was praying in my hotel room. I had this visitation from this angel with outstretched wings, and he stood before me and he identified himself as the chief prince angel of the Philippines. And then he said these words: prepare the nation for revival. Prepare the nation for a visitation of God. Teach their young to war in the heavenlies. Although these words were specifically spoken to me, but it also is applicable to every pastor, every bishop, every minister of God in this nation. Which means the word of the Lord that comes to you as a leader is: prepare the nation for revival. Prepare the nation for a visitation of God. And teach your young, the youths, how to war in the heavenlies. Our war is not with flesh and blood, but with principalities, with powers in the air. So you need to war in the heavenlies, because that time has come now. If you read Revelation chapter 12, verse 7, 8, 9, and 10, it talks about a war in the heavens where Michael and his angels will fight against the devil and his angels. So there's a war that goes on. And verse 10 tells us the remnant church on this earth has a part to play in the war. So they both join hands together for the last day's war in the heavenlies. And for the angels of God to win over the war in the heavenlies, the remnant church on the earth must participate together. Let me give you an example. In Exodus chapter 17, Israel goes to war with Ai in the valley of Rephidim. And God told the prophet Moses to go up on a mount, and he is to lift up his hands while Joshua and his army are fighting the war. So Aaron and Ur goes up together with Moses up on a mount, and Moses lifts up his hands and the war goes on. And Joshua and the Israelite army were winning the war. But you know, when you put up your hands, After some time you'll get tired. So you'll tend to lower down your hand. That is why most Christians today, foreseeing the tightness of their hands, they always lift up their hands halfway. Amen? So you know why put up when you get tired? Instead of lowering it down, you are already well prepared. You are very, very wise. So you put it halfway. You know, in the year 1997, I had been to Mongolia. And this one particular church, while the worship was going on, I saw one woman, young woman. She never lifted up her hands. While everybody else were lifting up their hands, this only woman, she just keep her hands straight like a wood by her side. And every now and then she will try to, you know, like throw up her hands, and then she would stretch straight. So I looked at this woman and I thought to myself, this woman is a strange woman. Everybody, not a single other person, had put their hands down. They all, everyone, young and old, lifted up their hands in worship except this woman. So I thought, okay, this woman is just like many Indians, no, lazy, who don't want to put up their hands. So I just thought like that. Every now and then I would glance at the woman, but she never lifted up her hands. But occasionally she would just like try to put up her hand. And I used to wonder why she's trying to do that when she can just jolly well put up her hands like this. Right? Jolly well and jolly be. Amen. Jollibee is better than KFC, you know. Amen. So much tastier. Hey, you must come and open a branch in India. So I can always eat Jollibee. Anyway, and after the meeting was over, then I asked the pastor a question. I said, who is this woman who never lifted up her hands? And he told me a very pathetic story about this woman. This woman got married very young. And frequently they had quarrels between the husband and wife. And one day, due to a severe quarrel with her husband, she decided to end her life. So when her husband had gone away, she jumped down from a high-rise apartment and fell down to her death. So when she fell down, she stretched out her hands to stop her fall. And in the fall, her hands broke to pieces. And she survived, miraculously she survived, but her two hands were broken to pieces. And the doctors could not put back her bones again. And instead of two hands, now she has two wooden hands. And the pastor told me, every time in worship, this woman will be crying when others are lifting up their hands. And she will struggle to push up her hands so that by the force of a push, she hoped that her hands will go up so that she can worship God. You know, when I heard that, I felt so condemned for judging that woman. Don't laugh. Don't laugh. I'm going to make another point after that. I felt so condemned for judging that woman. See how quick we are to judge people without knowing the truth. And I repented before God. And then when I had a chance to see the woman, I asked forgiveness for her and said, I'm so sorry for judging you. But you look at this, a person who has no hands is struggling to lift up the hands, but the people who have hands don't want to lift up their hands. So perhaps you should exchange your hands with her. Amen? Any volunteers? So Moses was lifting up his hands, and every now and then, when his hands get tired, he will let down the hands. When he lets the hand down, Israel will be losing the war. And Aaron and Ur saw that, and they realized there was a connection between Moses lifting up his hands and letting it down. So they quickly rolled a huge boulder under Moses, made him sit down, and they stood by either side to hold up his hands so that Israel can win the war. Now, what is the relationship between Moses holding up his hands and Israel fighting the war? What is the connection? There shouldn't be any connection. The angels of God are fighting together with Israel. But what is the connection to do? So I took it up before the Lord in prayer, because the Lord was teaching me about spiritual warfare and to train the youth army for the end time warfare. So I asked him this question: Lord, what is the connection between Moses lifting up his hands and Israel winning or losing the war? And this is what the Lord explained to me. He said, have you seen a lightning conductor on the roof of the houses? Have you? Do you have a lightning conductor on the roof of your house? Now, for the lightning to be specifically guided to the ground without randomly striking anywhere, the lightning conductor on the roof of a house safely guides it to the intended way, to the intended path, to the intended direction. In the same manner, when God calls someone to participate together in a spiritual warfare, let's say the captain on the earth, when he lifts up his hand, he is like the lightning conductor. And the angels coming down from heaven will look at the man that God has appointed with his hands stretched out. And they know this is their man. This is the captain of the Lord. And they come through him to fight together with the earthly army. So this is our part in the last day's war. So the young people were going to be engaged, to be involved in the last day's war, should be trained, should be taught how to war in the heavenlies. Now this morning or this afternoon, I shared with you the first part of this message where we talk about how the nation can be prepared for a revival. Tonight we are going to look at the second part of this message, to prepare the nation for a visitation, to have an encounter with God. God wants to visit this nation. So when God comes to visit a nation, how should we prepare ourselves? This is what we need to know. This is what God intends for the church in the Philippines, for the nation in the Philippines, for all believers as a whole, to learn how you should prepare yourselves, your house, your household, your church, your family, your city, your village, your region, and your nation for a visitation of God. So obviously, we need to ask a question: how to prepare a nation for a visitation? There are two important ways. Number one, when government leaders visit a city or a place, and the local leaders will run here and there to clean the streets, to paint the places and decorate the walls. Does it happen in the Philippines? Oh, same like India. You know, before a minister or a senator or a government leader comes, the local councilman or the local government leader don't bother. The street lights will not be working. The common areas where the water taps are, you can't even find a single drop of water coming, and all the roads will be broken. This will be the daily common life of everybody. But as soon as an announcement is made that the provincial governor is coming, suddenly you'll find all the contract workers cleaning up the street, all the street bulbs will be put up, and the whole street, the whole area, all painted very nicely, and it looks like it's Christmas time. And instead of Christmas, you will see a minister or a government leader visiting the street. Now this is point number one. The streets and the places are cleaned, painted, decorated. Point number one. Point number two. And then before they come, the things that are not orderly, the things that are damaged, are repaired. That's point number two. In order to prepare the nation, in order to prepare the church for a visitation, you need to do these two things. Now let's look at these two things in greater detail. Streets clean, painted, decorated. What do they mean? Let's look at Exodus chapter 19, verses 9 to 11 for an example. And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I come to you in the thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with you and believe you forever." So Moses told the words of the people to the Lord. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. Let them be ready for the third day, for on the third day the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people." So the Lord told Moses, "I am going to come down. I am going to visit the people. The people are going to see my glory." Before that can happen, the Lord told Moses three things to do. He must prepare the people with three things. Number one, he says, sanctify them. Number two, ask them to wash their clothes. And number three, husbands and wives should abstain from sexual relationship for 3 days. They should be separated. They should be clean. These are the three things God told Moses to prepare the people to receive a habitation or a visitation from God. Now, what applied to the people of Israel in the natural? Now we are going to look at it from the spiritual point of view. How does it apply to us under the new covenant? Number one, to sanctify means to fast and pray, which means you are going to establish a regular, disciplined life of fasting and prayer. You know, in the first century, when the New Testament church was born, there was a daily or a weekly disciplinary practice in the church to fast every Wednesday and every Fridays. Twice a week, the early church fasted. That was their custom. That was a practice. Now, this does not mean we are becoming very legalistic. This does not mean we are very religious minded. No. This is self-discipline. This is self-control. This is crucifying the flesh. This is bringing your body under subjection. If you read Matthew chapter 17, after the transfiguration experience, when the Lord Jesus came down from the mount, there was a commotion. at the bottom of the mountain, a father brought his demon-possessed son to the remaining disciples who didn't go up on the mount and asked them to cast out this demon, and the disciples could not cast out the demon. So the father cooked up a big commotion and he complained to the Lord Jesus that his disciples could not cast out the demons. And the Lord Jesus looked at the little boy or young boy who was demon-possessed. He cast out the demon and the boy was healed. And after that, the disciples asked the Lord Jesus a question, why could we not do it? And the Lord Jesus answered them, this kind does not go out but by prayer and fasting. So the disciples could not cast out because of their lack of faith. And in order to overcome this lack of faith, the Lord Jesus told them, you need to build a life of prayer and fasting. The very fact that the Lord Jesus could do that, it also means he himself was fasting and praying. That is why he could cast out the demons. So, the number one discipline that we need today, which is a great lack in our Christian life and in our church practice, is a lifestyle of fasting and praying. You know, most of the time we only fast and pray when we are in a crisis, when we are in a danger, then we proclaim a fast, then we fall on our face. And you don't even have to fast, because when you're so weighed down by your problems, you lose all appetite to eat. So you are under a forced fasting. Amen? You are forced because you lose your appetite to eat. But instead of that, if you build a regular practice of fasting and prayer, maybe following the example of the first century church, every Wednesday, every Friday, in our ministry, in our organization, we fast every Saturday. All our staffs, our entire office is shut down, and we all gather to fast and pray for our ministry and for all our needs. And then once a month we gather all our partners, because they're scattered all over South India, and we fast the third Saturday of every month from 10 in the morning right up to 4 in the afternoon. And one day, about 3 years ago, the Lord told me, teach the children also how to fast and pray. So we gathered all the children from 6 years old up to 12 years old to another room, and we have special children services for them. So for a long time, those children were not fasting, because it is a popular concept that children cannot fast. They are too young to fast. They always have hunger pangs. They must eat every 3 hours or 4 hours. This is a popular notion. So I went along the game and we provided snacks for the children at a break, like during lunch break. So a few months ago, about 6 to 8 months ago, when I was studying about all this, then a thought came into my heart. If we are going to prepare the children for the last days, we should also teach them the discipline of fasting. So I called my children's ministry team and I told them, this coming month, all the children are going to fast. No snacks, no drinks for any one of them. They can only drink after we finish the fast at 4 in the afternoon. So my staffs, they protested. They said, no, uncle, how can these children, they will die. Say, so I told them, don't worry, if they die, bring them to me. I will resurrect them. Amen. What are we here for, right? To resurrect the dead. Amen. Oh, then they said, oh, they may not die, but they may faint. So don't worry, if they faint, bring them to me. I have bottles of water. I will sprinkle the water on their faces and they will all get up. And they were still not sure. I said, don't worry, we also have doctors and nurses who come to our meeting, and they will tend to the children when they have any problem. So, with some reservations, yet they had to obey what I say. The very first month when we taught the children to fast, from 10 in the morning right up to 4 in the afternoon, 300 children were gathered in our little gathering, and not a single one of them complained for food or asked for water. Not a single one of them. And this has been continuing for at least 1 year now. The children have been trained. Amen. All these little ones, from 6 years old to 12 years old. So, the Filipino children should also be taught like that, how to fast and pray. Then they all will become sharp, mighty arrows in the quiver of the Lord. Amen. So, a discipline of fasting and prayer should be incorporated into our Christian life. Secondly, wash your clothes. Why wash your clothes? Every day we are washing our clothes. Don't you? Oh, only a few. The rest of you don't wash your clothes. My. You are just like the Tibetan people. The Tibetan people wash their clothes only once a year. Amen? So you are like the Tibetans? Only once a year? You don't wash every day. Or at least 2 days once. You don't. If you are really washing, you should be answering me. But you are not answering, you are keeping quiet. It means you are not washing your clothes. You know the Tibetan people, because of the harsh winter climate, they are not sweating. And because of scarcity of water, because water is very difficult to get, they don't wash their clothes. They don't even wash their pots and pans. You know, in the year 1995, I had been to a place in Nepal called Mustang. To go to that region in Mustang, we need to walk up the mountain, down the valley for 5 days. And there's no other mode of transportation. So we were walking for 5 days. On the third day, we had to camp at a small village for the night. So in every village, you know, the villages in that region are usually composed of 3 houses or 2 houses. That's called a village. You know, those people, it's all scarce area. So if there's even a 1 house, it's called a village. Anyway, so we entered into this house. It is also like a lodge where passing visitors can pay for a bed and for food and sleep there for the night. So we paid for the bed and we paid for the food. And there were, besides my 2 associates and I, there were another 2 Tibetan visitors who were also passing by. So the house owner was cooking food. So since the other 2 guests came first, they were served food first. And I observed how this lady was cooking the food. I like to observe how people cook, but I don't know how to cook, you know. So I was saw her how she cooked, and then she served the other Tibetans with food. And after serving them, that, you know, there were in the whole house there were only 5 plates. So 2 plates were used by this guest. So there were 3 more plates. So I thought, okay, the 3 more plates were for me and my 2 associates. And she cooked more, and then she put food on the plate, and this person, instead of serving to us, they were eating the food by themselves. So I thought to myself, there's no water nearby. How is this woman going to wash her plate? So I was very curious, because there are 3 plates and 3 persons are eating. So after she finished eating, she took the plate and she Leaked. She licked left, right, top, bottom until the whole plate was sparkling clean. And then she put on new food and handed the plate to me. Now I didn't know what to do, whether to reject it or to partake it. I can't reject because I was hungry as a bear. And then how to eat it when it contained all kinds of saliva, germs. I'm not kidding, no, Scout's honor. So I took up the plate before their hands, before the Lord. I said, Lord, thank you for the food. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I pray, the name that is above all name, let every germs die. Let this food be health to me. And if you want to know whether the prayer was answered or not, the very fact that I'm staying alive before you is a sign the prayer was answered. So, have you heard of Sadhu Sundar Singh? I'm sure you have. Okay. So once he went to the eastern part of Tibet to evangelize. And the following day, he took a bath by the river and he washed his robe. And then he sat by the river bank to wait for the clothes to dry so they can put on and go back into the village to preach the gospel. And while he was washing, he suddenly noticed that the entire village had gathered around to see him washing his clothes. And they were all looking with great shock. And then Sadhu Sundar Singh turned around and he looked at this whole village staring at him. And he asked them, why are you all staring about? They said, sir, you are washing your clothes. So he said, yes, what's wrong with that? And they said, sir, only sinners wash their clothes. Holy men don't wash their clothes. So all you people who are washing clothes every day, now you know who you are. So, if you want to be a saint, I am sure, as far as clothes are concerned, you don't want to be a saint. So, in the same manner, the Israelites are now walking in the wilderness. If you have ever been into the Sinai Peninsula, you will know that there are no waters anywhere. That is the reason why they were always complaining and grumbling to Moses to provide them water. So when there's no water, how to wash the clothes? You cannot wash the clothes. Furthermore, the Bible also tells us that God supernaturally made all their clothes to be clean, neat, and smelly good. That's what happened to them. However, on this particular day, the Lord told them, wash all your clothes, dry them, put on nice clothes and come and stand before me. Now what does that mean? What does that mean for us? Analyze your soul for spots of the flesh. You know, the Bible tells us, we have been given the garment of salvation and the robe of righteousness when we got saved. Two garments have been given to us from the day you got saved. And it is our duty to make sure those garments are not moth-eaten, and neither are they soiled or become dirty. So every day you need to analyze yourselves. Each night before you go to bed, don't just suddenly drop to your bed to sleep. Pause for a moment, maybe a 15 minutes. Analyze your heart. Is there any spot on my soul? Is there any uncleanliness on my mind? Is there any uncleanliness in my soul? If there are, you should be cleansed before you go to bed. You should not sleep with your sins and continue your sins the following day. Jude verse 23 and James chapter 5 verse 2. Number 3, come not near to your wives.